Welcome back everyone to the Video Game Fanfic Plot. I am your host Nat1995 with a new chapter for you all to the story A Spark of Life, in B1. Less than an hour later I was about ready to go homicidal on someone and the idiot across from Sam, Michaela and me was looking more and more like a very nice candidate. I had thought that since the United States didn't have a set magical government due to the unrestricted magical flows in the ground that I would be able to have a relatively normal summer only to be taken hostage because apparently my cousin's car was an alien robot, I might as well just get a sign saying that all weird things must happen to me or around me at some point. You need to let Harry go, he had nothing to do with this. I appreciate the effort but the man across from them certainly didn't look like the sharpest tack in the box. You can't fool me boy. He has the highest radiation ratings out of all of you, I won't be letting him go after he has obviously had such close contact with the NBEs. The man looked like Christmas had come early with a side order of Thanksgiving. The amount of data we will be able to get with someone with such large stable readings will be more than enough to get me noticed. You do realize that if you are right about the contact that we have had with these MBs that they will likely be doing all that they can to make sure that you don't keep us right? No sooner had I spoken than the SUVs all screeched to a halt and the top of the SUV that they were in was violently ripped off to reveal the same robot that I had talked to earlier. Well what do you know, I was right. The nearly violent look that was sent my way was definitely worth it. Hello rather large individuals. We weren't properly introduced earlier with everything else going on. My name is Harry James Potter and it's a pleasure to meet all of you. The robot that has ripped the roof off of the SUV blinked at me for a moment before he seemed to catch up. I am Optimus Prime, leader of the Autobots. We are Cybertronians. One by one the Autobots introduced themselves as Sam watched Michaela as she took far too much pleasure in making the idiot from earlier strip before she handcuffed him. Apparently Sam's Camaro was named Bumblebee, which immediately brought an image of Dumbledore in his favorite yellow robe to mind. The trigger-happy individual was Ironhide, the one with a British accent was a medic named Ratchet, and the smallest of the group was Jazz. I knew that they were all a bit confused about how well I was taking everything, but honestly with everything I've seen this is like another day in the life of Harry James Potter. We should probably get going in case they had some way of monitoring these guys and send reinforcements. Both of the other teens jumped when I spoke and nodded quickly before hopping into the newly transformed Camaro with me right behind them if somewhat less enthusiastic. When we began to speed towards the nearest on-ramp I heard the sound of helicopters only seconds before at least a dozen more SUVs appeared behind us and found that I am not fond of always being right about how badly things are going to go. I will admit that I was thoroughly impressed with how well Bumblebee managed to hold them off without hurting them until they managed to pin him down. I grabbed both Michaela and Sam by the arm as they tried to push their way through the soldiers and received glares from both. But this wasn't the time to be making even more enemies than we already had. Calm down, the only thing you will accomplish by shoving through them is pissing them off. What we need to be doing is keeping our eyes open to find a safe way out of this and keep these idiots from getting a hold of any of the others. They calmed down and managed not to put up too much of a fuss as the moron, Simmons I think, gloated about beating them and something about Michaela's dad that almost sent her into a fit until Sam stepped between them with a glare that he obviously got from his mother and got Michaela into the SUV. Thought you could get away from Sector 7, lowlifes like you don't stand a chance against trained agents like us. The guy that Michaela stripped, Simmons I think, took great pleasure in the glare she sent his way. I'm sure that the parole committee will love to hear about how well you're doing. It might even adjust their views on whether they should let him out or not. I had to quell the urge to cast a windless hex on him while Sam looked ready to go meet evil. Even though he didn't get the reaction he was hoping for he kept picking at them the entire trip and every moment made hexing him seem like a better idea. I would have gladly accepted a long road trip with Snape over Simmons, at least Snape had some standards for what not to mention. I'm sure that all of your parents will be thrilled to know that their children were consorting with dangerous extraterrestrials and undermining the world's safety. I felt some of my control snap. My parents were murdered by a British terrorist when I was a year and a half old and my only memory of them is their screams. I barely noticed how fast the color drained out of his face. The man that killed them is still alive too, and he still tries to kill me occasionally, so I highly doubt that consorting with aliens would be on their worry list even if they were alive. I turned to look out of the window at the dry ground speeding by as the vehicle went mercifully silent. Thankfully, the silence lasted until we arrived at their base of operations, which turned out to be the Hoover Dam of all places, where we were joined by the Secretary of Defense, a few soldiers that had apparently been attacked by a nasty Cybertronian, and two computer nerds that cracked the code. As soon as we entered the lower levels of the dam, I could feel a strange energy practically thrumming through the air. It flowed through me and helped relax me as I followed behind one of the soldiers, Will. The soldiers looked every bit as uncomfortable with the situation as I felt. There was nothing strange about the dam until we went through what was marked as a service entrance and were led down several flights of stairs until we arrived at a fairly large room dominated by a frozen alien that looked anything but friendly. I barely listened with one ear as Sam and Simmons fought over not only what to call this particular alien, Megatron or NB1. The alien that was frozen was much larger than all but the one called Optimus Prime, and there seemed to be something about him that called to me. I was shocked out of my reverie when Sam brought up something called an AllSpark and the fact that Sector 7 had it. Simmons made a grand show of bringing us to another large chamber that was dominated by a large metallic cube that the energy that still seemed to flow around me was coming from. The entire surface was covered with complicated symbols and small electrical shocks that flowed from the cube to the long wires that were attached to it in several places and looked like they had seen better days. I knew nothing good was going to come of the smile on Simmons' face when he led us to where the wires from the cube went a small bulletproof clear box. "Do any of you have a cell phone?" He took the offered cell phone from what looked to be a computer tech and placed it in the box before sealing it and flipping a switch on the wall. The box instantly filled with a bright bluish light that revealed a much smaller version of the aliens that had obviously been the cell phone. The only difference, other than size, between this one and the ones that I had met so far was that this one had red eyes and quite the attitude as it immediately tried to shot them. Simmons waited a few moments for the vision of a crazed cell phone to sink in before he flipped another switch, and the poor thing was electrocuted until it finally stopped twitching and I suddenly felt very sick to my stomach. As you can see, the subjects are all incredibly violent and have to be dealt with promptly. The clinical manner made my nausea even worse. Of course they're violent, you bring them to life in a cage that they can't get out of without anything around them that's the least bit comforting. Why don't you think about it for a half a second? Would you feel comfortable if you woke up in a box surrounded by other beings without any idea about what was going on or where you were? Every person in the room looked at me in shock, and I could practically feel the blush rising to my cheeks. Just because it's not human doesn't mean that it's not alive. Simmons was going to say something that I probably would have had to hit him for when the entire dam shook and alarms started going off all over the building. "Alert, NBE-1 containment system cannot be maintained, immediate evacuation recommended. Total system failure will occur in 10 minutes. "Well, that certainly doesn't sound good. The soldier named Epps barely got that out of his mouth before Will smacked the back of his head before we ran almost as one for the AllSpark chamber. "They're coming for the AllSpark and Megatron. We need Bumblebee, he'll know what to do about the AllSpark at least." Sam grabbed Simmons' arm and spun him around as they passed the AllSpark. "I will not let another one of the aliens loose when they are attacking us." Simmons got right in Sam's face as he rapidly turned red. The speed with which all of the soldiers drew their weapons and aimed them at the Sector 7 officers was impressive. I do believe that we are outnumbered and should listen to what they say. The look on Sam's face when we were led to Bumblebee to find at least 12 men shooting him with liquid nitrogen was enough to cause Michaela to step back in shock as we both ran forward and started pulling the men away. I was not about to sit back and wait for these idiots to obey Simmons of all people. Well, that's the ending of that chapter. I do hope you enjoy this video. If you like to see more, remember to hit that like button, subscribe to this channel, and leave a comment down below. Until next time.